And welcome to another episode of 72 Pin Connector. With us this week, we have Tom Webster.
Howdy, everyone.
Adam Jordan.
Hey, what's up?
And myself, Eric Fine. So how have you guys been doing this week?
Well, on this episode of the 72 Food Connector, we have coffee. But it's not just any coffee. This is Folgers Magic Instant Coffee Crystals.
Oh, God, no.
Target brand generic.
What have you done?
Target brand generic half and half and 2 tablespoons of sugar in my giant superhero mug.
What have you done? Folgers Instant Coffee?
It's so fucking bad. Okay, all right. So, all right, there's a story here. My wife doesn't like making a full pot of coffee because she has maybe half a cup of coffee like once or twice a week. And she's not a coffee snob. I'm an absolute coffee snob. Like, I buy specialty beans, I've got a burr grinder, I've got a French press, I've got the Alton Brown method of making my coffee. It's perfect in every way. It's delicious and amazing. But
you're made for Seattle.
It was 6 minutes until we went live, and I had no choice. This was it. Oh, this was the coffee, and I was falling asleep. It was this or fall asleep during the podcast. And I do have to say, it's instant coffee. It's not good. It's definitely bad, but it's not as bad as I thought it would be. It's actually pretty drinkable.
So
if I was on a deserted island, I would have this.
Full disclosure, that's what I drink every morning whenever I have coffee at
Eric,
home.
Stop.
I have Nescafe in the big glass jar that you get in the Hispanic section.
No. Stop it.
Your Seattle privileges have been revoked. You're not even going back to Ohio.
Yeah.
You're not even going back to Ohio. You're going to Alabama.
So that's it where we're takes putting me you. 30 seconds to make a cup of coffee in the morning, and that's it. And it doesn't taste terrible. If I was to give you that compared to standard roast Folgers some shit or even Dunkin' Donuts bag blend, and I was to put five out there of each, I guarantee you would at least pick it wrong once.
Don't you hassle the Dunkin'. Dunkin' Donuts is by far the best like mainstream coffee product you can buy on the market today. And for all you Seattle nerds out there, come at me. Starbucks is shit. I like drinking coffee. I don't like drinking ashes mixed into hot water.
Starbucks.
If
standard
you buy the blonde
fine.
Roast and actually grind them before you use them, it's pretty good.
Yeah, I don't mind Starbucks coffee.
I loathe Starbucks. Absolute loathe.
But you got to get off that instant coffee thing, Eric.
Yeah,
if you need
some real coffee.
You can get you a French press. It doesn't take that long, and you can do other stuff while the water's boiling and whatever.
Yeah, but you have to understand, when you are up in the morning and you are waking up super early and you are trying to get out the door by waking up as late as possible and getting ready as soon as possible, waiting for water to boil, it takes longer than it takes me to get out the door in the morning.
Dude, I have a whole coffee like religious experience in the morning. I grind my beans, I get the water to the perfect temperature, I've got it timed out perfectly, so my kettle, when it clicks off, I know exactly how many seconds it takes to reach the perfect temperature so I can add a little bit in and get the beans wet before I fully fill my French press. I add a pinch of kosher salt and that takes some of the acidity edge off. It's amazing. It's perfect. You're gonna come over to my place, you're gonna have a cup of coffee, and it's gonna change your world. It's the best. I've got the best coffee. All of the people wish they had as good as coffee.
I wake up, I brush my teeth, I comb my hair, I hit the Keurig for hot water, and I'm out the door. That's it.
If you have a Keurig for hot water, why don't you just get Keurig coffee? That would at least be a step above instant coffee.
Well, because Keurig coffee costs like $1.50 a fucking K-cup.
Whatever.
I'm sorry. I'm a penny pinching son of a bitch on certain things.
That's fair.
But I will admit that standard coffee is better. Yeah. But it just takes so much longer. So fuck that noise.
So Adam, to move on to our next topic on 72 Food Connector, I believe you had some specialty tacos tonight. Would you mind telling us about those?
Yes, we had tacos from the wonderful restaurant that our friend Jesse works at.
Which I've completely forgotten the name of already, because we're bad friends.
But it's in a I don't want to say not popular area, but it's not like, it's not a super nice city. It's kind of a
It's not a dump. It's not.
No, it's not a dump.
It's a city that looked like it was going to start and actually become something and then died.
Yeah. Yes. It doesn't seem like the kind of place you would find a really, really good, like, gourmet taco place.
Guerra's Crazy Taco in Springfield, Ohio.
Yes.
This place, on the outside of the building, they've got a slogan that says, "We're a taco truck without wheels."
Yeah.
And you walk in, you order at the counter, and literally all the shit that they have is on a chalkboard on the side of the wall. And they've got the most amazing specialty, you know, made right there tacos. It's amazing. I got stuff that I don't even like. Like, you know, pepper, like whole peppers on a taco and weird cilantro ranch sauce. It was so good.
It was great.
You don't like peppers on your tacos?
One of them had candied jalapenos on the top of it.
Yeah. Oh my god, I don't even like jalapenos, but it was spicy, but then you get the sweet to mellowed out and it just blended perfectly. There was this taco I had called the OMG, and I took one bite of it and I was, oh my god.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
Oh my god.
It was so good. It was weird, really good. Sweet sauce. It was, oh man. And the guacamole is a mix your own. So they basically give you all the chopped up stuff in a platter and they say, yeah, do it up the way you want, and they give you a spoon. And they use like a blueberry, really cool. Or not blueberry, a cranberry mash in their salsa. So it's this sweet, sort of spicy salsa. It's really good stuff.
Yeah.
But yeah, 72 Food Connector. Can completely recommend Guerrero's Crazy Taco in Springfield, Ohio. Go there.
For the record, I like straight jalapenos. I prefer straight jalapenos on most things. Yeah. I like candied jalapenos, though. I think
on certain things, yeah,
they're a great top. Like for me, burger. I think a candied jalapeno on a burger is really fucking good. I think that's better than it is with like flesh or fresh sliced
jalapenos. Or pickled, even.
Yeah.
It depends on the burger for me. Like if you're having a burger with like some Colby Jack and maybe like a hot radish sauce on the bottom bun, or you know, what's another fancy food thing you can add?
Oh, like a
saffron. We'll do some saffron puree and
carrot truffle. And squash puree,
truffle oil fried burgers with saffron and Iberico ham.
Food.
All right.
So beyond food, I think we do have a little, not a whole lot new going on this week, so this part will be quick, but we have been playing a little bit of stuff.
Just a
tad. I played nothing. I played like an hour of Rocket League. That's it. I feel like I've betrayed all of you because I told you I would have Resident Evil 7 done by this podcast, but I just have not had the energy or the time to play games this week at all. So
we've asked you here to have a conversation, Adam. We feel that your performance at 72 Game Connector has been lacking for some time. We need to put you on an individualized employee improvement program plan.
Okay.
To help synergize your productivity with the business.
At least 18 hours of gaming per day for the next 2 weeks to get off of probation.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. Mandatory. I'll get right on that. All right.
Streaming at least two-thirds of that.
I'm going to jump off the podcast now and get right to that.
that's the kind of spirit we like to see. That's the go-get-em attitude we need in this organization.
If you're not throwing away your career to talk about video games, you're not doing it right.
Agreed. Yeah. Agreed.
Career. What's a career?
I don't know. I just quit today.
So I haven't played anything, so don't dwell on me. What have you guys been playing?
I played one game, and not that much of one game. And do you guys have any idea what I played this week?
Dark Souls 2?
Maybe. Yeah. So, I've
for those of you taking tallies, you can put another tally mark on consecutive weeks of Dark Souls talk. Yes. And I think at this point we're at 3 or 4 months.
Those of you participating in the 72 Pin Connector podcast drinking game, go ahead and just chug the bottle and die.
Dude, that would be such a good fucking drinking game. Anytime you mention Rocket League.
Any Dark Souls, Rocket League, or Switch talk, take a shot. Now you're dead. You die.
Is Tom ranting on that list anywhere?
Yeah.
No, we don't want to kill our listeners.
So I've gotten past several bosses now. One of the things I'm really liking about Dark Souls 2 is that the game feels, and it feels this way, and I'll get to it, but it feels, as far as multiplayer goes, way, way, way more active than Dark Souls 1 was. And one of those reasons is when in the options menu, it gives you the option of playing from people in your vicinity, basically your country, or worldwide. And in a game like Dark Souls, where everything is basically normalized and on a level playing field, and they have voice chat, but I've never actually used it. It doesn't matter if you're playing someone in a completely different country, they're still going to tell you, try jumping next to a bottomless pit. and they understand the universal language of, hey, I summoned you into my world so you can help me kill this big-ass thing. And they go, yeah, let's go kill a big-ass thing. I partnered up with this dude that used two shields to bash this guy in the face until he fell over. It was amazing. But the game feels really easy for a Dark Souls game, right? You still die all the time, but it does feel a whole lot easier. I don't know if that's because I've gotten good or because I've got a lot more people playing with me and leaving messages, so I'm more involved in the community and, you know, people jumping into the game, but well, I don't know if I like it. I'm getting through it. I don't know if I like it, though.
Well, I will say this real quick about your first point. We know it isn't that you got good.
Yeah, probably not. Probably not. But yeah, it's interesting. That's really all I've played. And I found out that there's several, just like Dark Souls 1, there's several different paths you can take through the game. And I'm on apparently a really weird path that people don't usually take. So I don't know. It's getting easy. I'm hoping that what I did was I hit a brick wall and I sort of like built myself up enough to climb over it. And now I'm going to go back to those other bosses I have to beat. And I'm just going to walk all over them. I don't think that's what's going to happen, but I'm really hoping. So we'll see. But that is all I've been playing. Irk, what have you been up to?
Boring.
So some of the same old, as Adam said, Rocket League. Been getting used to the new ranks, and now I get to get used to something else that we're going to discuss later. Did some Zelda, still fucking awesome, but there was a new release on all platforms called Has Been Heroes. I picked this game up, and this game is fun.
What is it?
So it claims to be roguelike. Well, I shouldn't say it like that. It makes it sound like it's not. To look at this game without reading genres, it seems like a JRPG kind of style when I first saw it. And then I realized the enemies are actually advancing closer to you in Plants vs. Zombies kind of way, where they progressively get closer. And then I find out your characters can switch lanes. So it's lane-based timed attacks.
Oh, that reminds me of Mega Man Battle Network or something.
Oh,
not familiar.
Yeah, I forgot about that. That was great.
Those were great games.
So it's really, really cool how that mechanic works. And then your people take damage when things get too close. So you have to kill them or knock them back before they get too close. And enemies have endurance. And each hit you hit removes endurance. Certain enemies have certain amounts, blah, blah, blah. And certain or heroes you have will hit 3 times in one attack. And it'll be a little bit each time, or they'll hit one huge attack. So if you're only going against endurance, someone who hits 3 times for less damage is actually better because it removes the endurance all the way. So it's kind of an interesting strategy mechanic when it comes to that. But the way this game plays out is really cool. So you have this map. And this map's made up of all these nodes that are connected through different paths that you can take. You start at one spot, and at the very far end, you see there's your boss. Go. So you get to traverse this map however you want. That is randomly randomly generated every time. And you have essentially every other node is a special event node. So you know it's no battle. It's going to be a shop, or it's going to be a stamina recovery area, or it's going to be a mage store or something like that. In all the other ones, it's a chance of it being empty or being a battle, where you have to fight off these waves. So you manipulate your way through this, earning gold and these different orbs that later unlock more things in the game. So you work your way to the boss, you fight him, you die. And then you just do it again. It's a run-based game. And you unlock more heroes as you go. I've yet to unlock them, so I'm still frustrated because I still suck at the game. I enjoy the piss out of it, but I suck.
I have to get good.
I beat the first boss now every time. I just can't get through the second boss to get through the first area. It's like in Isaac. You have basement one, basement two.
Right.
I'm beating basement one. I'm not getting out of basement two.
Yeah. So this game sounds really interesting. I love the run-based, like you said, the run-based gameplay. The, you know, you can get through a run in a relatively short amount of time, and then you unlock more things that you beat the runs more. You know, at the first, when you don't know what's going on, it's always the, can I at least get, how far can I get? And then you get a little better, you get a little farther, and then you get good enough to where you're beating it just, you know, a good amount of the time. And then you start unlocking things and, you know, doing better. It's a lot. It's really easy to get addicted to games like that if they're done well.
Yeah, and this is, and there is actually a lot of strategy to the combat. And then I'm sure there's going to be synergies to the items. So you can pick up random items through the game that you have to buy. And some of them are, oh, your character gets an extra stamina, so he can get one more hit before taking damage. Or your spells on this character recharge 10% quicker. Hmm. And it doesn't tell you what the item does, much like in Isaac. You just see the item symbol. And then you have to choose which character is picking it up. And once they pick it up, it's done. There's no swapping. So right now, I end up a lot of times where I'm picking up an item with my really like finicky hit twice. I'm a wimp, but I have a good spell guy. And it's like, oh, your melee damage is boosted. It's like, well, shit, one times five is only five.
Right. It's like picking up the wrong item in Isaac and ruining your run.
Yes. So there's going to be some synergies to it. And characters seem to have like 20 item slots. So it looks like you're going to be able to get a lot of different items, which is cool. The thing that's kind of fun is at the end in Isaac, you unlock things solely by beating. Just by playtime, you tend to not unlock things. Most things are unlocked by getting past a certain point, getting past a certain boss, blah, blah. On this, every time you kill something, you get these orbs. And when you die, you're up at seeing the gatekeeper. And the gatekeeper has this big center orb, and it says 0 out of 80. And all of a sudden, your orbs start going in to fill it up. If you don't fill it up, it's there for next time. Once you fill it up, you got the unlocks for that level. So even as you die, if you completely suck and don't advance any further than you've ever been, you still continue to unlock new things. So you don't stuck in a rut. So I thought that was really interesting.
I'll have to try it out.
Something to what Dark Soul is saying in chat, I want to point out that it does appear to be a game that is going to be littered with microtransactions when you look at it. So I'm not super deep in it, but I will say from what I've seen so far, I don't see an easy way for them to actually do microtransactions. Since it's a run-based game, it's not going to be possible to really get those microtransactions. What I see is DLC packs for more items to introduce more items into your game, which I feel are different than microtransactions. More in a name than actually anything else, because I think microtransactions, I think, get quick for 5 hours kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. It depends on how they implement it. If it's, you know, an item that's, you know, invincibility for 72 hours, then you want to make sure that the DLC pack isn't pay to win, especially if it's got items.
This game doesn't allow for that kind of stuff. That's what I'm saying. This game doesn't set up for those type of items. This isn't Clash of Clans kind of thing. This is if this came out for PC, I would have just thought, oh, this is kind of cool. Consoles, it fell out of place because this is not a type of game I'm used to seeing in a console. But on the Switch as a handheld, this is beautiful.
So looking at the pictures, it sounds like they've made a really cool game, but they hired the same guy that does like all of the artwork for Clash of Clans and Candy Crush and all the mobile games to do like the art and the interface.
So these guys did do other things. I can't remember their previous work, but artwork, it does look like that. But as you start to play, you see there's a story. This isn't just some blind spend hours advance, because it's throwaway, it's run based. So I think that is what's going to keep this pure.
The art guy was sending them back their sprites and stuff, and they're like, he's like, are you sure you guys don't need this dollar symbol with circle around it button?
Like, no, I have five different ways I've displayed the word purchase with different words so people don't realize it. Are you sure you don't want those?
They're like, nah, we don't need that. No,
I'm wondering if just because of the artwork in this game, that it looks so much like a microtransaction laden mobile game, that gamers like us, people that have been around it, that have, you know, looked for mobile games on their phone because, oh, cool, it's a tiny computer, I should be able to game on this all the time. And then you get into the, you know, the Google Play Store and you're like, what the fuck is this? This is all shit. Every single game in here is shit.
Dude, half the time, just by the thumbnail in the Play Store, I can tell whether or not I'm even going to be slightly interested in it.
Exactly.
They all have that same art style in the thumbnail, and I'm just like, nah, I'm not. I don't want to do that.
I'm wondering if that art style will actually hurt the game. And it's something new that I don't think we've seen in the industry yet. You know, at least it's a brand new phenomenon to me, where just by looking at the artwork, you can tell it's an absolutely shitty game. You go back to the NES era and you look at something like the Mega Man box art, right? Which is the classic example of something that looks like absolute shit, but plays really, really well. And that's, you know, famously bad box art. But you go to the Play Store now and you see the sort of cartoony, in those sort of cartoony 3D rendered proportions, you know, characters, and you just know. I'm wondering if that's going to end up hurting their sales.
I don't think it will, because this isn't mobile. This isn't a mobile game. This is a PC console game.
So, I mean, if I'm looking at games on the Switch and looking at games to buy, I'm going to look at this compared to, you know, Isaac or Zelda or Mario Kart or whatever the Switch has, right? All the Switch games, or the F-Zero like game that you are playing. And I'm going to look at that and then look at this game next to it and go, yeah, I'm not going to play some shitty tablet game. I'm going to play F-Zero Lite.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is this is on more platforms. This is on PlayStation 4. This is on Windows. I mean, this is PC. This is console. This isn't just on Switch as a possible mobile game. I mean,
points in its favor, for sure.
Because, I mean, that alone gets you out of the, is this a money trap? Because, granted, there are some microtransactions in certain console games, but it is not something that's common at this point.
I wouldn't say that at all. Just recently, just like it happened this week, I logged into Steam, and I got one of those good Steam pop-up ads of, you know, here's what's new in the store. Fallout fucking Shelter, the mobile game Bethesda just released on the Steam store. So now, in case you didn't get enough microtransactions on your phone, you can now get them on Steam as well.
Now,
and I can't rip Fallout Shelter too much, because as far as the microtransaction-y, you know, wait or pay to win games, it was one of the best I've ever played. But it's still one of those wait or pay games. So
keep in mind, one game that you're seeing, or maybe two or three, amongst hundreds of thousands, I'm still saying it's not common. I mean, that still holds true. It is not a common thing in the PC world, while Tom's over there sneezing his fucking brains out.
I'm so glad I've got this mute button.
So yeah, it's a fun game. I plan on getting a little further. Hopefully see some, I don't need any more mechanics, but I'm sure I'll see something new, or all of a sudden I realize I've been playing like a dumbass this whole time. But I think
that's interesting. I'll have to look at it.
That is all I've been playing. So a lot of Zelda, a lot of Rocket League, and a little bit of that, because that didn't come out till Wednesday. So I've only got a little bit of time on it. But we do have a little bit of news that happened. Not a whole lot. It's been still a fairly light week.
Some big news that hit early this week, and I'm so excited to talk about this, is Blizzard loves StarCraft. And they still love StarCraft, and not just StarCraft 2. StarCraft is going free-to-play. Like, the original game, it's going to be free-to-play. It's going to have some updated multiplayer components, updated cheat detection, better matchmaking. I mean, it's getting a pretty substantial revamp. Also, a totally different project that Blizzard is working on. Starcraft, the original, like Starcraft Brood War, is getting a full remaster. New graphics, nice. Better gameplay, menus. I mean, the whole thing is getting a complete overhaul in the graphics and sound department.
Yeah, but is up to 4K is what it's going to.
Wow.
You Starcraft cool. purists are out there like, they're going to build this on a new engine and it's going to be shitty. It's just not going to feel like Starcraft. That's not actually the case. They actually took the base game code from OG Starcraft Brood War. Legit. Like, the OG, this is how shit moves, this is the damage it does, like, everything line by line from that game's engine. And they just removed the graphics and the sound, and they're building all the interface stuff on top of the old-ass code. So, it is perfectly, precisely the original StarCraft.
I think this is
to a mirror sheen.
I think this is them realizing that StarCraft 2 died off a lot quicker than they thought.
Yes.
Now, don't get me wrong. There is still a very competitive scene over in the Korea. But
yeah.
They're wanting this to be bigger. They're wanting this to be more. And what's a better way than A, give people StarCraft 1 to try, because they know there's a whole generation of people that have never seen StarCraft 1. Mm-hmm. Secondly, remaster the shit out of one of the best games they've ever made.
If this happens and this, you know, sells well enough or gets enough players interested, I'm so excited because it means they might do this to Warcraft 3. And I am so excited about that.
Yes.
Holy shit. But this is a huge deal. And I realize this is totally nostalgia bait by Blizzard, but
yeah,
it's Blizzard and they can get away with it. They don't use this card too often, right? It would be like Valve putting out a completely remastered version of Half-Life or their hit game, probably their biggest and most well-known game, Ricochet, putting out a remastered updated version of that.
I'm watching the trailer for this. It does look pretty good.
Yeah, it's, and
like, granted, the graphics are quite a bit better, and it kind of has that 2D cartoony, it'll always look okay sort of vibe to it.
Yeah, it's like
one thing Blizzard really has good always
pixel
been.
Art kind of thing.
Yeah.
It's one thing Blizzard has always been absolutely brilliant at, because even if you go back to, you know, OG World of Warcraft and videos of OG World of Warcraft, it doesn't look bad. It certainly does. It's not amazing or astounding or technically impressive, but nothing looks bad. Nothing looks of poor quality. And that's because Blizzard has always chosen art styles and aesthetics over sheer graphical powerhouse. And the reason they do that is because, you know, World of Warcraft and StarCraft needed to run on grandma's computer and, you know, the super gamer's computer and everyone in between. So they've got to make it play well more than look good.
They're really good at this. I don't know how else to put it. They're fucking fantastic at it. But there is an important question. With them doing this, what do you really want? Would you rather see StarCraft, or would you want to see 1, 2, or 3 Warcraft? Because personally, I was always more of a Warcraft fan. I don't know what it was. I just like the character set. I like the aesthetic of Warcraft a lot better than StarCraft.
It honestly depended on my mood.
Yeah, I kind of see. I never did get into StarCraft at all, and I did get into Warcraft 3, but I think I do like the aesthetic of StarCraft more, and I like the 2D models and textures better than the Warcraft.
If I want to play sort of an action RPG RTS, I will go to Warcraft 3. Because it does have the focus on the central hero in most of the missions. Mm-hmm. StarCraft is definitely your tried and true RTS formula, where you've got, you know, it's just you and an army. And yeah, there's some story stuff thrown in, but it's basically an army.
Yeah.
There's no centralized hero character.
Mm-hmm. I like that. That was the one thing I didn't care for about Warcraft 3, and that's why I'm not even slightly interested in League of Legends or Dota, is because I wasn't into the central hero focus And it might just be because all of my RTS experience has pretty much been Command and Conquer.
Such a good one.
So but, I kind of gravitate more towards the whole army aspect and less of the hero thing.
While I like Warcraft 2 more than 3, when it comes to RTS, I like Warcraft 3 because of all the online variants that were able to spawn because of heroes. And I'm not just saying Dota. There was stuff like Pudge Wars, and they had
tower defense.
The tower defenses you were able to do on a lot of stuff, but they had interesting tower defenses on 3 because you had a hero that would run around. They had hero wave defenses that were really fun, where you send waves and try to kill things with your hero. And one of the coolest things is you were able to do RPG, like whole RPG setups, where you get this hero and someone would make a map that would be an RPG that you would play your way through. And someone was acting the world of Dungeon Master and dropping enemies on the map while you did it.
That's really cool.
That is some of the coolest things about Warcraft 3, but it is probably one of my least favorite RTSs I've played.
Yeah.
Total Annihilation.
I was going to say
was one good. CNC was good.
I didn't play the old ones, but Planetary Annihilation, I did like the commander aspect of it because it wasn't like your main, you know, attack force. You had to, it's basically something to protect, but it's a unit, and I like that aspect of it.
And that is how Total Annihilation was. Only Total Annihilation had where PA, it was weak in the sense that there was no factions. Everyone had the same units. Yeah. Total Annihilation, you had like 100 and some different types of units per each one or each side, arm or core. So for arm, you would have a peewee. For core, you would have a scavenger. And they would actually be slightly different units. It's not just one was called the other. One would be a EMG type weapon while the other one's a laser. Mm-hmm. And it just added so much more depth that just never happened in Planetary Annihilation that ultimately made that just short of what it needed to be.
Mm-hmm. I think my main issue with Planetary Annihilation, because I did end up, I think anyway, backing the Kickstarter, is, and this happens to me with a lot of early access games, and it's a pretty interesting problem from a game design and marketing standpoint. When you release an early access game like they did, because I got it at, you know, pretty beta of a stage. It was very rough around the edges. I played it. It was pretty unoptimized. It didn't control very well. There was like hardly any tutorial aside from some YouTube videos. And it was a good time. But it wasn't great. I saw no reason to go back to it. And of course, it's like the earliest beta. So they updated the game, and I've just never gone back to it because I feel like I've already played it, even though it's a completely different game today than it was when I played it.
Yeah.
And I think that happens to a lot of gamers as they'll play these early access games, be totally done with the thing, and then, you know, never go back when the game's actually a full game instead of a tech demo that they can try to sell.
That's what's happened to me with The Forest, but I do plan on going back into it.
Yeah, it's one of those things where they openly were talking that early access is early access. Don't expect a full feature. And optimization was something that came way later because they didn't get an actual full-scale animator and stuff until the very end of the process.
Yeah.
Because they built up this engine with the idea that other people would mod it because TA was always open to mods, and that's what they were hoping with the PA.
Yeah, I like what Uber Entertainment does. It's they run into brick walls of problems a lot of the time, though. I love Monday Night Combat. It was so good, and now it's dead. So we've got another story, and I'm all about hating on this company because I'm just full of hate and bile and poison and fuck GameStop. So Irk, what's going on? How are they fucking you over today?
So this will be a quick one because it's just universally shitty practice. GameStop is telling people that if you want to switch, we'll have some in over a month. Or you can get a Switch with Zelda, with the Zelda guide, with Bomberman R, which is a piece of trash, and with Snipper Clips for an actual fair price, but we'll have that to you next week. So
fuck that.
If you buy a huge bundle through them, get it next week. If you don't give them all that extra money, we're not going to give it to you for over a month.
Wow.
That is shitty. That is absolutely shitty.
So, yeah, go GameStop.
I'm thinking we should add GameStop hate to our 72 PC drinking game.
Yeah, probably, because there's not going to be much good.
It's getting to be to that point.
Some really cool news. Destiny 2 is confirmed. It was leaked earlier. It's confirmed now with the launch date of September 8th, including PC. So everyone is going to be able to play. I was never in on Destiny. I missed the initial entry point, and I don't like coming in too late on that stuff. I think I might give this a shot. Don't know about you guys.
So we do have... It's interesting. I never got into it because, you know, PC gamer. I might. I don't know. It always seemed interesting, but with MMOs, especially like that, you've got to kind of get in on the ground floor to really, you know, get the full experience.
Mm-hmm. Nothing is carrying forward on this, though. This is a complete, everything's thrown away from the first. There's some shitty backstory about everything blew up, blah, 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 something like that.
I'm good with that, because I don't want anything carried over from the first game that I never played. If I'm going to start an MMO, I want to start on the ground and build from there. You know, going to, you know, Final Fantasy today, it's a little intimidating, because when you grow up with these systems, you've got, you know, systems on top of systems on top of systems on top of systems. And when you're growing up with a game, it's like, oh, cool. It's a new patch. It's been 6 months. I have this new feature. This thing is really cool. My character can do this now. And it's a pretty easy, you know, cognitive load. But when you get into it, you're like, holy shit, there's 47 different types of systems and mechanics I have to learn right now to be able to play the game at even a reasonable level. There's no way. There's absolutely no way to do that. Yeah. Keeping it simple and culling out systems is a good idea, but it's hard to do from a design perspective, because you don't want to piss off people who love those things, and you don't want to throw away your hard work because it's your baby.
And I don't think they're going to have too much problem getting people to move forward with the game. It's kind of like, to me, going Borderlands 1 to 2. I know that they're going bad on their 10-year plan, but they've kind of acknowledged that they really fucked up the development on the first one, so they had to start fresh. They've done about everything they can with the old one.
I don't know how you could even... In this industry, you can't make a 10-year plan. There is no 10-year plan. There's year plan.
I think that you're going to see more games doing this. I really do. Because Destiny was the first of the console ones to really do it.
I think it'll be interesting, but I honestly don't know how you can say with a straight face, without knowing what the console landscape will look like in 10 years, to say, yeah, we can keep this going for 10 years. No, you fucking can't. You absolutely can't, right? The game, the console manufacturers themselves are saying, oh, it's a 10-year life cycle. And then by year 7, they're like, so we got this new thing coming out around the corner, or by year, you know, 2, they're like, oh, well, VR's a thing now, so we've got this pro version coming out over here that's twice as expensive and has a headset.
You can transfer saves.
10-year plan.
Console lives are not an issue. Hey, it's happening with multiple games currently. It's going to happen. But anyway, we did have one more tidbit of news, really small, haven't been able to confirm it yet, but supposedly Nintendo has addressed the frame rate issues with Zelda.
Oh, cool.
Which is really good.
That's really good.
Because playing handheld was the best way, because it didn't get the frame rate drops, which I experience regularly because I play a lot in docked mode. Uh-huh. They will get so bad, the game locks for probably a good second and a half.
Mm.
It just straight up stops.
That's real bad.
Real
I think this is actually, this is better news than just the game functioning properly. What this says is that given the, you know, how underpowered the Switch is compared to its competition, you can engineer and optimize around it even after you've launched a game. What this says is something as awesome as Zelda isn't constrained by the Switch anymore. They were able to fix the problem in software.
Okay,
I'm really excited about this.
Listen, I love this game. I love this system. You know what it really says? Oh yeah, we were finally able how to figure out how to run consistent frame rates at 900 resolution. Congratulations. People have been doing that for over 10 years.
A good point. I will concede that.
But I'm glad to see it nonetheless, because I do like the game and I love the platform. And that is all the news, because this is actually not a very busy news week, because all the fucking games came out in the last 2 months. So, to fill up some time, we did want to do a little bit of a topic. This week, we wanted to kind of talk about sequels that took it just a little too far. Because developers love to milk that cash cow. Yeah, just a little. You know, so they love that.
About the series that should have stopped a long time ago.
Yes.
Or you have series that they should have kept just one game for.
You have a beautiful thing.
They should have never launched.
Well, see, I don't want to get too much into that, because there's a whole lot of those. But, you know, you got that golden game. It's just great. It's beautiful. And then the next one's just like, what the fuck are you doing?
Right.
Cash grab!
So when you posted this question in our little group chat thing, and I was thinking about it, and I was like, oh, yeah. Resident Evil. Oh, wait. They kind of revamped it with 7, and it's getting really good again. And then I was like, oh, okay. Well, Sonic the Hedgehog. Oh, wait. Oh,
God, yes.
Sonic Mania is coming out, and that looks really good. It looks like they're going back to the roots. It's like, ah, damn it.
And see, I was thinking the same thing with Final Fantasy. They keep doing this to me. Because Final Fantasy 11 was OMMO, 12, but then 15 supposedly is really good. It's different, but it's good.
Mm-hmm.
So it's one of those things where sometimes they write the ship.
Yeah.
Other times, they just are fucking bad, such as Dukem Nukem.
Duke Nukem.
Forever should have never happened. I know Tom wanted to get on Duke Nukem, and he's hating on it before I even am.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah. So I've got a lot here on the list. But one thing I want to cover that's near and dear to my heart, which absolutely should have ended after the third game. Well, third game with this title, is Metal Gear Solid 3. It was clearly the pinnacle of the series. It was the perfect amount of WTF LOL and the perfect amount of like feels in really good, powerful moments in a game. I mean, you start the game off with like the really cheesy James Bond-esque theme that you're kind of embarrassed to listen to. And then by the end of it, you're like belting it off of the top of mountains or like shedding a single tear as you climb up the ladder slowly while it's softly playing in the background. Metal Gear Solid 3 is by far the pinnacle of the Metal Gear franchise. And 4 just didn't live up. It was one of the best 15-hour movies I've watched. But you don't play those games. I haven't played 5. I'm not even interested in playing 5, because I just know Kojima said, oh, you know, it's a nice cohesive story plot thing you got there. It'd be a shame if someone convoluted it.
No, what you're saying about 4, I completely agree with. I bought a PlayStation 3 specifically to play Metal Gear Solid 4. That was the only game I bought the system for initially.
And thank God for you, The Last of Us came out.
And I never even finished the game. I got like maybe halfway through and I just kind of lost interest in it. It got a little too weird for me.
And you got tired of watching a movie?
No, I don't mind that at all. That's part of the series. You know what you're getting into.
Yeah. But
it just, I don't know. It took the weirdness a little too far. And it started to
if you only got halfway through, you have no idea. So I'm not going to spoil anything, but at the end, like all the weirdness that you see like towards the middle gets even fucking weirder, and then like literally in the last 60 seconds it just gets totally turned on its head and then expanded, and then you're not sure what the fuck is going on. Nice. And then it's like, I'll see you in Metal Gear Solid 5.
I gotta interject, because you guys, I think all of us are kind of excited for different reasons on Death Stranding. And I keep pointing out what you just talked about is the reason people shouldn't expect greatness. Because everyone thinks Kojima off the fucking, like not cuffed, is going to be great. the shit he was doing when he was cuffed was so crazy it borderline ruined the games.
It did, but on one hand, I don't know how much of that is Konami saying, hey, we need another cash cow because, you know, the coffers are a little dry tonight. And how much of that Kojima, and I don't know how much of this was Konami and how much of this was Kojima, but he kept saying after every single fucking Metal Gear Solid game after 2, this is the last one. The series has ended. It's final. It's done right here. He said that after 2. He said that after 3. He said it after 4. He said it after the 5 demo-ish thing. And he said it after 5, and they totally cut him out, so it had to end, sort of. But he's always said this, so I don't know how much of that is cash cow milking by your publisher and how much of that is him just being nuts. If you could give him a single game to work out whatever weird issues he's got going on in his head, is like game development style therapy, I think it's going to be amazing, but only one game.
Yeah.
Only one game, please.
So, Adam, any games in particular for you that you thought should have just stopped? So I know for me, big one was Halo 4, because it, I love 3 online. Loved 3 online.
See, I lost interest in Halo at 2, but I just never, I didn't get into it as much as you did, though.
2's campaign was weak. It still told a good story, but it was weak. 3 brought it back home. The multiplayer was great.
I could see that. Yeah, the campaign was better in 3, for sure.
4 fucked up the campaign a little bit. It wasn't that great. And massacred the multiplayer.
Yeah.
It was just... just like Prototrix is saying in the chat, 4 and 5... You could see that they started to feel the COD influence. They still did weapon on map, but they gave you too much, and 4 especially, too much options on your starting weapons. 5, they dialed it back a little more, though.
Yeah. Speaking of which, Call of Duty.
Oh, I had so much respect for this series. So much.
I don't like the new game every 6 months to a year kind of thing.
Well, shit, they have 3 different companies doing it now.
Yeah, that's just completely unnecessary.
You know how everyone makes fun of Madden because they release the same game every single fucking year?
Yeah.
Every year, it's the same goddamn Call of Duty game with another skin. Or, oh my god, this time there's a dog.
Yeah, it seems like they're trying too hard to try to gimmick interest into it with new things that seem out of place or don't work when... They had a perfectly good kind of arcadey, modern, or, you know, World War II era shooter. Older COD games were a lot of fun.
So
Call of Duty 2 was amazing, and it was an Xbox 360 launch title. I bought it on PC, and holy shit, it was amazing. It was cinematic. It was powerful. You played as the Ruskies. It was great.
So I think COD... While we all think they started to suck, I think it was more so it just didn't change. And they kept selling the new games and it gave us a bad taste.
Yeah.
I think their massive hit with Modern Warfare. Modern Warfare was a huge, absolutely warranted, best-selling hit. It was a great game. It had brand new... You know, multiplayer modes that did a lot of really cool, interesting stuff that just wasn't common at the time. You know, slapping RPG leveling systems and upgrades into your multiplayer FPS. That's fucking weird. No one was doing that before, and now everyone's doing it, and it just got old. The campaign was, it was just long enough. It was powerful. It had a lot of great set pieces. It had moments that really were pretty thematically impactful as a first-person shooter. Most of the time in any other game, you know, run around and kill Nazis for, you know, anywhere from 4 to 8 hours, and then you're done. In this, you fucking get hit by a nuke and you die slowly as you wander out of your downed helicopter, and you're like, holy fuck, that was kind of a moment.
Yeah.
And so, after that, everything just downhill.
They need to pull a Resident Evil. They need to take, like, 2 years off of new Call of Duty games. And they need to come out with a really good, solid World War II era shooter.
Okay, so good news for you.
It's been a while.
The next one is World War II. That has been confirmed. Really? Yes.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Because think of it this way. There's a whole, once again, a whole generation of players that don't know Call of Duty used to be World War II. Yeah. Also, just so we can get off of this real quick, what was your favorite Call of Duty? Which one?
One.
I didn't play one and two, so honestly, probably Modern Warfare, the first one.
I think mine was probably Modern Warfare 2.
Or maybe World at War. I'm not sure.
World at War started to do a lot of the things I liked about Modern Warfare 2. I just liked the Modern Warfare era of it.
Yeah.
With the choice of being able to choose your different kill perks.
So I've got one that that VW has mentioned in chat and was actually on my list here.
Yeah.
Tony Hawk's Pro Skater should have died after Tony Hawk Pro Skater 3. It was the best in the series. It had perfected the formula. It had perfect create a skater and create a park modes. It was the absolute peak of that series, and everything after that has just been grasping at straws. 4 wasn't bad, but it wasn't particularly good. Everything after that was terrible. Absolute shit.
So I have a tweet out there that I'm going to put back out on 72 Pin Connector. I want everyone to see. It is fucking hilarious, and it breaks down the Tony Hawk Pro Skater timeline, because this tweet is saying that BAM is the reason Tony Hawk started to suck. And you can actually see you can see a fork out of Tony Hawk Pro Skater 4 where it says Tony Hawk meets BAM. And then they say that there was a battle between BAM and Tony Hawk and who won, and it splits the timeline even more. And you just start to see all these different timelines getting shittier and shittier with different games. And it says, and all of a sudden he tries to go back in time before BAM was ever around, goes back up to the top, and you see Tony Hawk Pro Skater 5 to try to get rid of all the underground shit, all of the downhill racing. Why the fuck did they do a racing game?
Yeah, that doesn't make sense.
I actually they needed a Wii accessory.
I actually liked Tony Hawk's Underground, though.
I didn't. But I was always, even... So I was a wannabe skateboarder back in the day. I always sucked. I was absolutely terrible. But to me, Tony Hawk's Thug was the epitome of, like, the skater lifestyle at the time. That was... It was so cool and radical and punk and it just... That sort of thing always rubbed me the wrong way. It always annoyed me and felt really just fucking lame and preachy and wannabe. I never got into it. I know people that did. I know people that absolutely love Bam Margera and that whole crazy cast of, you know, jackass rejects, but it always drugged down the experience. Instead of Tony Hawk Pro Skater being about doing tricks and basically mixing fighting game mechanics into a sports game with an arcade style point counter, it was, we're gonna like shit in a bowl and throw it at this guy because I'm BAM and that's what we do because we're crazy kids. It was just fucking lame, the whole thing.
Yeah, to me, there's... I didn't like the Skater 4 was okay. Everything after that was just, ugh. So, yeah, Tony Hawk's definitely on that. There's another thing I was brought into chat that we had discussed slightly earlier. Assassin's Creed.
Yeah.
They laid out such a good and interesting, such a really interesting story in the first one. Yeah. And the game did so well, even though people still thought it was repetitive, it did really well. And then they just drive that to the fucking ground. This last year was the first year we didn't get a new Assassin's Creed in how many years? So, I mean, it's
not enough. Not enough, yeah. Frankly.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that series right there was something I was really shocked that they kept going the way they did. I would have thought it would have stopped way before that.
All you have to do is, for a lot of these series, you have to look at the company behind them. And one company in particular is just absolutely famous for running its franchises into the fucking ground, and that's Ubisoft. Related to that, one game that I didn't put on the list that we absolutely have to add is Far Cry. There should have only been one Far Cry game, because there only is one Far Cry game, as far as I'm concerned. Two was shit, three was shit, four was shit, literally everything. Maybe I'll give Blood Dragon a pass, because it was fucking weird and hilarious. But other than those two games, everything else in the series has been utterly forgettable. Yeah, there's some interesting mechanics, but the original Far Cry was such a weird, jungly, explorey with this really odd sci-fi horror twist right in the middle that totally changed the way you played the game, and everything else just completely ignored that. They're like, Far Cry 2, oh, you can light fires and you have malaria. Congrats. All right.
I've never played Far Cry, but I heard the really interesting thing about 2 was the way the systems played together, because it's similar to what Zelda does.
Mm-hmm. But they don't. I mean, they do. The systems do play well together, but there's no reason that the systems play well together. There's no reason that you want the systems to play well together. You have fun while playing Zelda, right? It's fun.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So in Far Cry, you can either kill this set of guys for, like, a diamond or something, or you can kill this other set of guys for a diamond. And you can kill them from this direction or this direction. And sometimes you can light a fire to kill them, and sometimes you can light a fire over here to kill them. Really emergent gameplay right there. Totally different experiences. You can shoot people from different angles. They've got, like, this weird civil war thing going on, and you have to choose a faction, but you don't actually choose a faction because you kill everybody.
That's the way it should be. Mass murder.
The game makes no goddamn sense. I hate every new Far Cry game. The first one was so great and such a sleeper hit, and then everything else was just shitty.
And there was another one you wanted to throw in the mix there, wasn't there, Adam?
Yeah. Five Nights at Freddy's. Why are there so many of those?
It was
a cool novelty at first. It got a lot of traction, and they should just stop. Like, how many did they put out in such a short time?
They put
like,
out
wasn't there like multiple ones released in a really short time frame?
Yes. I actually bought the most recent since I didn't have one, and I was kind of wanting to play one like that.
Yeah.
And it actually was shit.
Like, it's cheap jump scare simulator.
I enjoy the actual gameplay. I kind of think it's an interesting concept. The scare is jump, 100%. But the idea that you're trying to track these robots through security cameras, I think is kind of cool. But yeah, the third or the last one wasn't like that at all. And it was just really stupid. Do this, do that. You fucking lost me.
Yeah, yeah.
So another game, and this was also mentioned in chat, was Katamari Damacy. And I actually, people in chat were clamoring for a sequel, but I completely disagree. The first game should have been it. It should have been, here's your weird Japanese game with the most amazing soundtrack that I've actually been listening to this week, amazingly enough. And that's it. It's done.
Yeah.
You like Katamari. It's over.
I love it. It's amazing. It's perfect. But 2 felt like a cash in, and then everything after that felt like nostalgia bait for, oh, remember that quirky Japanese game you used to love? Here's a soundtrack beautiful. That's not quite as good.
Beautiful Katamari was amazing.
It was good, but it wasn't one good. It was way better than 2, but it never hit that peak again.
Well, you don't have to hit the peak again. I mean, if you make a masterpiece the first time, you shouldn't be held to hit a masterpiece the second time.
Exactly.
Just
so
make it
why
good.
you can't beat it. It's the best version of Katamari you're ever gonna get. That's where the series should have ended, right there. And speaking of series that should have ended at their peak, Irk, you and I played this co-op for hours upon hours. Like, we put 40 hours into this game at least.
I think Adam even played with us on that.
I played a lot.
Oh yeah, you did. Saints Row 3. It was amazing. It was great. It was funny in all the right ways. And 4 was literally the same world map with a bunch of shit strewn in it that you had to collect.
Yeah,
the
I remember.
The thing that impressed me about 3 was they took this series that was seen as a Grand Theft Auto knockoff, and then they're just like, you know what? We're going to up the ridiculousness up. We're going to just make this batshit crazy. And it worked so well. It set it apart from Grand Theft Auto, but it had enough similarities that, you know, it would appeal to the people that liked Grand Theft Auto. And it was so good.
And then 4, I felt they tried to cash in on the comic book shit while keeping while ratcheting up the craziness. And they just tipped the scale.
Yeah,
they tipped the scale.
It went from a game about ridiculous gangsters to a game about, or gangsters who are ridiculous, to a game about just pure ridiculousness. There was no semblance of anything from the first or second Saints Row games, except for they tried to tie it back with some weird like time travel shit that just felt really fan servicey. And for someone who, you know, didn't really get into the first or second games, I could care less about, oh, look, it's a previous version of this character who looks totally different than the new version of this character for some reason. Okay.
So I think, to put it quick, the way you know it's off the deep end, within the first 10 minutes, you're the president, you cure cancer or world hunger, you get abducted by aliens, and you become a superhero.
Yeah, that's basically the whole
game. The fucking intro to the game. Oh, and you're in a simulation. You're in Rick and Morty simulation inside a simulation type of simulation.
Yeah,
welcome to bullshit.
Too much of that.
The last game on my shit list right now is Max Payne 3 should have never happened.
I loved Max Payne 1.
Oh, it was so good.
I played a little of 2. I didn't play all the way through.
2 is by far the peak in the series.
Is it really? Okay.
Yes. So Max Payne 1 was this incredible... If you haven't played Max Payne, please, for the love of God, it runs on toasters. It was this beautiful game that came out around the same time as The Matrix, but they were developed independently and they don't know anything about each other. Because The Matrix came out and Max Payne came out around the same time, and I was like, oh, they're copying each other. No.
Just because of the bullet time. It had literally nothing else in common.
Yeah. So
bullet time and trench coats.
Yeah. Max Payne is a game about a hard-boiled New York cop, and his family gets killed by druggies, and then he's going on like this crazy suicide revenge run to murder gangsters and solve a mystery. And it's very film noir. It's very graphic novel-y. Got, you know, the hard-boiled voiceovers of, you know, the rain was coming down like the mayo on a steak hoagie sort of stuff.
Oh, yeah, Batman.
It's so good. Yeah,
it was. It had character and vibe just oozing out of it. It was so good. And the gameplay was fun. It wasn't just a story experience. The gameplay was really good.
Going back to a previous point, you can tell quality when you look at the name on the tin of you know who the product is made by. This is a Rockstar game through and through. They're not afraid to take chances. Absolutely. They're not afraid to do weird shit. Max Payne 1 was a piece of art. And so Max Payne 2, they said, okay, how do we follow up this amazing game, one of, you know, the best PC games we've ever released? So they took everything that wasn't absolutely pristinely perfect. They destroyed it. They shredded it. Just buried it from the ground up. And then they built it out of gold to recreate it. And not only was the gameplay absolutely perfect, but the story got even better somehow. And it's because they decided not to opt for the typical, renegade cop storyline. Instead, they went to the next sort of trope in film noir, which is the femme fatale, where you fall for the girl who's clearly bad for you, and she's probably gonna kill you, and you probably deserve it, but you're gonna do it anyway, because that's what you do when you're a hard-boiled detective who's popping pills and killing dudes. You fall for people who are bad for you. And it's a beautiful, amazing love story of a video game that's just so well put together. I love film noir to death, and that's probably why I love this game so much. But 3 never lived up to the hype. It was just angst on top of angst on top of alcoholism on top of angst, and I just didn't feel like Max Payne 2, which wasn't a hopeful game, but it was an impactful game.
Yeah.
And that's all I've got for my list.
So before we get out of here, let's throw this around, and it was actually brought up in chat. What is a series you want to see come back? Not something that's in the works, but something that's just like, you know, it'd be kind of cool to see this. I personally want to see another Ogre Battle. Hasn't been one since 64. Yeah. Do it.
I mentioned this in chat, but I would like another Shadow of the Colossus. But I'm torn in this answer because I love it when there's just this excellent masterpiece of a game, and that's the game. There's no sequels, there's no franchise that gets run into the ground. It's just this awesome game, and it always will be. But I just want like 10 more Colossi with, you know, better graphics and a beautiful world to explore on your way to them, and the interesting mixture of platforming, puzzling, and action. It was just such a good game, and I want more of it.
I want, and I realize what I'm asking for, because it was already ruined. I want Perfect Dark to come back. I want a good Perfect Dark game. Because it was so good back in the day. Just so good. Perfect Dark Zero was so bad.
Perfect Dark was good. I just, there was nothing about it that made it stand out outside of dual wielding and bots.
The whole series was just, the whole game was cohesive. It was perfect. It was, let's take GoldenEye. Let's take this first-person shooter console formula and ratchet it up to 12. That's what I loved about it. It did everything perfect. And then Zero came out.
So, you know, everyone out there, you should tweet at us at 72PC Podcast and let us know what you would like to see come back at some point. Because we're done. And we got no more games to tell you about. So you can come check us out at our YouTube channel in case you're listening to us here on Twitch and didn't really know about us before tonight. And the YouTube channel is 72 Pin Connector. Or likewise, if you're at our YouTube watching this or listening to our podcast, you can come catch us Friday nights at 10 p.m. Eastern on our Twitch at TV/72 Pin Connector. So, unless you guys have anything else to add, I think that's all we got for this week.
No, that's it.
Yeah, that's it. All right.
So, until next week, game on.
See you, everyone.
Game on.
And done, and for the love of God, I gotta piss again. Fuck, I'm an old man.